Previously on Monster Vlogs, Charlie and Haley watched The Bride of Frankenstein. Haley smacked Charlie and then made a creepy face. Okay, now back to part two.
But back to the vlog.
Everything was leading up to her. And it's in, because it... I'll save the biblical stuff for last.
Yeah, we're going to do that. Everything was leading up to her, and I want to say that I don't know if this was necessarily a female empowerment story, because it still was very much about the monster wanting a companion.
Well, it loved, this story loved women. Like, every woman with significant screen time. And who is the screamy lady that you don't like?
Oh, I don't know. I just wanted to see her die in this movie, and she didn't.
She was in Invisible Man.
She was in Invisible Man, which was also directed by James Whale.
She's a character actor, and one part of her character is being very shrill and screamy. But she's very... I find her funny.
Honestly, in this movie, I actually noticed a resemblance between her and the twin witches in Ocarina of Time. Like, the twin witch boss characters. You don't know them, but they are... Anyway. But
she was simultaneously helpful and not helpful.
Yeah, because she was...
The monster's over there!
We don't believe you. There's no such thing as ghosts.
Victoria should be here.
And almost breaking the fourth wall. She's, looking in the direction of the camera, but looking off screen.
Yes.
Or facing the direction of the camera, but looking off screen.
He's like, no one believes me. Oh, well.
But,
I think she's hilarious.
Okay, that line was funny. Oh, man. But
I love this movie so much.
Yeah, it was good. It was really good.
It was a well-made movie.
It was well-made movie, and it shocked me a couple times.
Which we've come to expect from James Whale. A very well-made movie.
Dwight Fry is in this movie again, but not as Fritz.
Twice as scruffy looking as last time, but with a different name.
Yeah, he's, what, Kurt?
Carl.
Carl this time around. You know, being an assistant to the mad scientists, but...
And an interesting theme, there are two of them this time. And they're criminals that Praetorius literally nabbed from death row.
Homeboy straight up murders a chick just for the heart. And he Frankenstein just doesn't know.
He doesn't know, and Praetorius knows.
Which is
another thing that makes him odious. And they keep it from him. I have a really huge theory about the bride because of that.
What's up?
Okay, because...
That he intentionally catered her for himself?
Or maybe... Well, listen to me. Because in the movie, they focus on the heart as, this unpredictable organ.
The unpredictable, and the most complex organ.
And it's just a boom, thump, thump, thump. Anyway, but because that woman's last heartbeat was in fear as that woman, she is...
Yeah.
The bride is born in fear.
That makes total sense.
And because the monster is so big and imposing, she extrapolates her last moments being murdered with the monster, because he's so big and imposing and he's... doesn't know his own strength. Victor,
fear
who is
and
the
distrust.
Only... Yes.
And that's... And,
the the only one she seems to warm up to is Victor.
Yeah.
Because he's the one that birthed her. He's her father.
There does seem to be this weird paternal connection with them.
Yes.
It's very much his procedure to get these creatures living. But another one thing I wanted to bring up is that Elsa Lanchester... I guess the direction from her is move your head a little weird. I'll just move
that
it like
was
a
all
bird.
Her. That,
that
was all Elsa.
That was all her. But
she
in retrospect, with that theory, it kind of fits in. She's quickly searching around. Okay, what happened? Who did this? Oh, you're kind of creepy. You're touching me. You must have killed me. And that whole screen.
It kills me because they would have been such a cute couple.
She is gorgeous.
She's so beautiful. That is one of the most strikingly beautiful character women in film history. I think Elsa Lanchester in that role is more beautiful than Marilyn Monroe.
Yeah, I definitely agree with Elisa.
So striking and just beautiful.
I agree with Elisa in that, you know, she deserves more recognition.
She's a very popular pinup subject, actually.
Well, I mean, you want to show off your freaking little poster again? That's enough of a pinup right there. She, look at her. Look at that skimpy. Look at that skimp.
Look. That's what you do when you...
I may use that for the title card. Just be like... Friend.
But they would have been such a cute couple if they had just gotten to know each other. Because the monster was so harmless.
So harmless and also very mistrusting. Now let's talk about him and one of the best
character arcs ever.
No. Best, I'm calling it right now. This is not only the best scene in any Universal horror movie that I've seen, this is one of the best scenes I've seen in any movie. Just him interacting with the blind man in the cabin in the woods.
He's been so mistreated by the villagers just because they don't understand him and he doesn't understand himself. He's wandering in the woods and he finds this blind hermit, like, almost, hermit in the religious sense as well as in the popular sense. Because used to, hermits were holy men that would just go off into the wilderness and, you know, minister to people who were lost. But, you know, go off in the wilderness and just be them and God. But the blind hermit, like, is so accepting of the monster. And he teaches him to speak. And he teaches him, like, all these things that his father should have taught him.
Well, his father taught him.
His father was in on it. And just shows him the most pure, undiluted kindness. And finally, the first person to touch the monster's soul. And nurture it.
Yeah.
And there's the world's most beautiful scene.
Finally giving him this is finally satisfying.
Karloff, who is an acting genius, keeps up this hand gesture when he is in need of human interaction.
Like when he walks into the camp of the nomadic people.
People.
Thank you. I learned my lesson from Hunchback.
Good boy.
Just linking that video. Notice he stops that when he meets up with Pretorius.
Because Pretorius, like any toxic friendship, seems to give the monster what he needs while really just manipulating him to do what Pretorius wants.
Yeah. But he doesn't continue that gesture until he meets the bride.
I mean, she is made of, like, the dead bones.
How did they get the skin on? That's what I would... It was just bones and a brain and a heart.
I think you know, they used the existing bones, and Praetorius grew brain and flesh, and all they needed was a working heart. And the zappy zap.
Well, I mean, electricity is obviously the key to life in this freaking universe. universe! Okay, I'm smart. but there's one last aspect that we have yet to talk about, and it's I'm going to let you do all the talking on this.
The most Christian horror movie I think I've ever seen.
I think I may have to subtitle you on that one. I'll keep doing that. That's actually cooling me down.
But this is about the love and mercy of God. Visually, that is what it is about. There are so many scenes that's like, God's children need to be loved, and he is one of God's children. Because there's freaking crucifixion imagery when he gets captured by the mob the first time.
Granted, it's more of a Michael Jackson pose. Oh God, was that where he got it from?
I sincerely hope not. And then once the blind hermit is brought into it, God is specifically name-checked, and a scene that still makes me cry, where, you know, Frank, the monster, is The hermit lets the monster sleep in his bed. He's shown him the first true, genuine kindness he's ever known in his life. And the hermit prays to God, thanking him for such a wonderful friend that's been brought to him.
Like, literally the first person. Because the monster is a person in this film.
Yes.
I mean, body count aside, he is a person.
Every inch of person. And most of, like, what he does is in self-defense and not understanding. And same as last time, in my opinion.
And a couple of times he's actually trying to save people. Like, he tries to save the shepherdess.
Right. He tries to save the shepherdess, and that's when the crucifixion imagery happens. But...
Oh, wow, there were a lot of lambs in that scene, weren't there?
Yes, there were.
James Whale, what were you doing, sir?
Visually, James Whale was in very frame. Much about this. But in the scene with the hermit prays over the monster, and they both start crying, and they show...
A single little tear from the monster... Oh, and they both comfort
each other, and it's probably the first physical affection the monster has ever had. And it's
like,
it's
why couldn't this guy create me?
So touching. And there is a scene where the monster is running from the mob, and he literally takes refuge under the cross. You cannot get more visually blatant than that.
Granted, it is in a crypt.
But it is a statuary.
It's framed in such a way that the cross is in the background.
It's like stairs leading to the crypt, and then there's a crucifix. It's not just a cross. It's Jesus on the cross statue.
It is the depiction of the crucifixion of Christ.
And he literally takes refuge under that, and that's what saves him.
The blood of Christ saves the monster.
At least
that scene.
And from the hermit onwards, the monster is changed. He is led a bit astray by Praetorius, but it's from Praetorius twisting his own needs against him, because the monster wants a friend.
Well, if we're continuing the Christian imagery and the Christian symbolism, he is literally meeting Praetorius for the first time in the catacombs of what is hell in this movie.
The symbolic hell.
In the symbolic hell. Because he says friend to a dead girl. Well, I mean, he says friend to a dead girl at the end of the movie, but, you know, according to Colin Clive, she's alive.
But if you think about it, you know, like, he does not want to live anymore because...
Because there, I mean, he
what
he
comes
says,
after is more comforting than what is now.
He says that to Praetorius, like, you know, dead, good, alive, not good. Like, wow, you're certainly wise beyond your years.
And Praetorius name checks the Bible a lot.
He name checks
in a very twisted way, which is what Satan of the does. Bible. So yeah.
He does it in like not. He does it to spite the religion.
He does it in a very acerbic, twisted way, which is what the devil traditionally does. But, and it, even in the creation of the bride, it's Adam and Eve.
Oh, yes.
Very much that. And, I'm gonna geek a faith it eventually.
I think you have. I think halfway through the episode I've already turned this into a geek of faith. Have we seriously been talking for 30 minutes?
It's a good movie.
It is a good movie. Yeah, it's a favorite now. Like, even...
Oh! Yeah. There's even, like, visual repetition. If you notice... Like, I just noticed it this viewing, and this is the second time I've watched it. I love finding new stuff. But in the first scene... It's Mary Shelley, Percy Shelley, and Lord Byron.
Right.
And Mary Shelley is wearing this very flowing white Regency dress with this lovely stole and draping behind her.
At the end, the bride
and
is
the boys
wearing...
are in these very button-up like waistcoats and stuff.
It is two guys and
it, even at part of the scene when Mary pricks her finger on her needlepoint, the two boys surround her, like get on either side, sit down with her on the couch, and Percy looks at her finger and she's like this, like. And at the end, once the bride is created, she is surrounded on either side by Dr. Frankenstein, who is more sympathetic and warm towards her, and Dr. Praetorius, who sees her more as a fascination.
I think that was intentional, just to
In the beginning, Lord Byron describes himself as England's greatest sinner, and Praetorius...
Was it sinner or singer?
Sinner.
Oh.
Lord Byron was a poet... and notoriously bad boy. Look it up, children. Look it up. And Dr. Praetorius compared to Mephistopheles.
Comparison to Mephistopheles.
Well, he compares himself to the devil and the little people.
I guess so. He literally puts a lid on the king. A literal lid on the king's jar.
Anyway, and the bride is wearing this flowing white dress.
A flowing white dress, as if she is a bride. I mean, I think the symbolism there is if she was a bride. They weren't. I highly doubt they were thinking of this in 1935.
It is no coincidence that Mary's dress in the first scene and the bride's outfit
were very
visually the same. They cut the same silhouette. So it's meant to call back.
Her hair is even kind of like back in there. Okay. Mary Shelley in the beginning of the movie is more like that design. Well, obviously not with the lightning bolts down the side. But
there, she does have like little hair combs like right here.
Are they white?
They're diamond.
Okay, maybe it was intentional. I'll shut up now. Okay.
But the similarity is so interesting because it's two men thinking they're smarter than her and fawning over her when really she has her own power.
Like, we're going to create him a companion. Well, but she don't want him.
She's just not that into him.
She's just not that into him. Hell, you never know. She may want to, like, go off and write the story of a man.
I maintain that Elizabeth should have been part of it. They needed a motherly influence, and you know, like Elizabeth, like she's scared. Boys, give her time.
Well, I did
because I thought that was so cute. It was like a whole first date kind of thing because they set the monster down on one part of the couch and they set the bride down on the other part. They're like, "You two hold hands. We'll just wait."
Imagine if they just went to the carnival and all that.
Like, we're gonna put you two in the Ferris wheel. Oh, aren't they cute?
it's an like, arranged marriage.
It's like two matchmakers just fawning over their match.
Oh, man.
And they would be so good together. Anyway, that's beside the point. It's my little shipping heart.
Anyway,
and the end was just spectacular.
The end, like, that was the absolute theme and the whole, like, linchpin of the movie. We belong dead.
Someone finally got the monster's opinion of his own existence, and that's what he said. And it's interesting because the influence of the monster's time with the hermit. Because in the first movie, the monster threw his father off a window.
Mm-hmm.
In the second movie, he sees that Dr. Frankenstein is loved, even unto death, by Elizabeth. Another badass move by her.
Like, you go live.
Because
you stay.
You got no one crying over your grave. You're staying right here.
It was so awesome to see that set again. Like, I was geeking out over seeing the set again. Like, oh my god, it's stage 12. They're back in the laboratory. Well, I did call it the laboratory before stage 12, so I guess that's the impact these movies have been making on me. Mm. Oh, this is still going to be a fun ride. We're not even halfway through it.
But it was just, he has seen the effect of love. And in that moment, the monster showed mercy like he was shown, bringing it back to the whole Christian aspect.
Yeah.
And, oh, it's such a good movie.
And I get the feeling if I don't cut you off now, you're going to keep talking about this movie.
I think I'm exhausted. The topic.
You're done?
I'm done.
Not even a Geek of Faith on this?
There will probably be a Geek of Faith on this, but I'll wait till Halloween.
I'll wait till I see that. What did Haley draw today?
Today, inspired by...
It is a badass drawing, guys.
Inspired by Dr. Praetorius' little scene with the people jars, I drew the mermaid in a jar, but I drew her in a way that you don't want to let her out.
Come on. Focus. Focus. Focus on the drawing.
There we go. It looks more focused to me.
Yeah.
I'm definitely going to finish that one.
Yeah, because you're going to Kamikaze this year, aren't you?
I hopefully am.
You're going to be going to Kamikaze with Morgan, right?
Yeah.
Wink, wink, link, link.
And I'll probably make a series, like more...
More like Monsters in Jars? Yes. The Praetorius series?
Yes.
Oh, that'll be fun.
Because Kamikaze starts on Halloween.
Okay. Standard questions.
All right.
Horrifying to a 1935 audience.
Yes.
Because there was heavy advertising in the trailers, like, for the first time, hear the monster speak. I was like, I already got that with Mummy. I know Boris Karloff's voice very well.
But this was very different from the Mummy in how he spoke.
That just proves how versatile he was as an actor.
Yes. I love the way he played the monster. It's just,
like, the way he played the... I can't even remember the butler's name from Old Dark House. The way he
Morgan.
Morgan. I just said Morgan. The way he played Morgan in Old Dark House was very similar to the monster in the first Frankenstein movie.
But still distinct.
But still very much distinct because he still was, like, this grisly kind of man. Grisly kind of guy.
Grizzly Adams.
Mummy... Or Imhotep was basically Egyptian Dracula, but with a little more, I would say a little more class than Dracula. Like, Dracula was classy
more
from,
conniving
from a Hungarian English standpoint. This was like old world, old country, sort of.
Older country, the like, first country, like Africa.
Egypt.
Oh, and by the way, I learned that Boris Karloff was Indian.
Okay, so horrifying to a 1935 audience, yes. Final thoughts?
It's very dreamlike. There is this kind of hazy, misty quality.
Oh, yeah.
There's a very good interview with Neil Gaiman on The Bride of Frankenstein and why he loves it. And then part of it is because it's not so much as straightforward a story as Frankenstein. It's more...
It's actually a more developed story than any of the monster movies we've seen.
And thematic. It's hugely thematic.
Because in the monster movies we've seen so far, there is a distinct line in between, you know, what is supposed to be good and what is supposed to be bad. It started to get a little blurred with the first Frankenstein. This one, it's a little all over the place because you have Frankenstein doing what he's trying to do just to get his girl back at the end because the monster steals the girl.
Praetorius her using the monster,
kidnaps
basically.
Her. Yeah. Okay, so everything was orchestrated by Praetorius.
Right.
And he is... Okay, I am in total agreement with James Rolfe. That is the better mad scientist than Colin Clive's Frankenstein. Because that is, like, evil.
He's an evil scientist. Colin Clive may be a little bit mad, because you can tell he's like there's some bats in the attic here. But
that is
Praetorius, an evil boy.
Because he not well, I mean,
he needed that.
Because Colin Clive's Frankenstein, his whole deal was like he was excited and deranged by the idea of creating life, but had no idea how to harness it.
And it's treated almost like a monomaniacal mental disorder.
Exactly. Pretorius, though, has perfected it.
He know what he's doing.
He knows exactly what he's doing. This is my first experiment, and it's a freaking fully fledged human, tiny human queen. And all the jars, and he has perfected it to the point where he can create a human brain. This man, please, Hayes Code. Doesn't care.
He does not care about people who are not him. You see it over and over again. He does not care for
No regard for human life.
He does not care for human death. There is nothing sacred to him. They did very good job comparing him to the devil.
Oh, yes. And on that note,
I love this movie.
This movie is amazing.
I love the bride. I love Elizabeth. Elizabeth, my girl, y'all. Your opinions, dear. What are you doing?
Presenting the next one. Ah, ooh, Werewolf of London. Ding ding dong, ding ding dong, da 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 da. If you like this, please do subscribe by clicking our faces. There's the last video we saw the black cat. Da da. This next one is Werewolves of London. Cut. Is it werewolf? Don't you dare sit down yet. You're not turning the damn camera off this time. No, I will not allow it. Bye. No. No. My job.